Hello and welcome back. This is the next video in the certification called Sustainability Climate Risk called SCR. This video would discuss about chapter 41 to 44 of this certification. This is the presentation outline. Let's study them one by one. So for the very first topic, which is identifying carbon risk. So we know that scenario analysis is given by TCFD. They are recommending every firm to have their own scenarios. These are the bullet points for those scenarios. So scenarios are plausible, hypothetical concept. They are not a true picture. They are not precise forecasts. Your forecasts could not be actual. However, scenarios help in strategic decision making. Senior management can use this scenario for deciding how the company should progress in the future. It would help them understand what is the climate risk, and then they can disclose the risk to public and investors. But there are challenges for bank to incorporate climate risk. The first challenge is that there is limited empirical data for climate change, climate risk. There is no theoretical research paper that can give details about it. Bank's time horizon, which is around 1 to 5 years for calculating any risk, this is not quite right for climate risk, which are in the time scale of 10 to 30 years. Also, bank can't compare them based on different industries. Banks have so many clients in different industries, and they need to have a homogeneous method to decide how to interpret climate risk and what should be the amount of it. They need to incorporate climate risk which is systematic as well as repeatable and consistent. Also, bank need to tailor it to the organization that is under their portfolio. They can't have a thing that they are dependent on something else. There needs to be coordination across multifunctional teams, which is finance, HR, etc. Now, for scenario analysis, so these are the things that are required. So first, you need to have governance in place. That is, you need to have an enterprise risk management system that would give oversight and would discuss about the relevant board committees and subcommittees that are relevant to it. This governance would also identify the external and internal stakeholders that are relevant to climate risk. The second is, it would assess the materiality of climate risk. So usually it is based on transition and physical risk. So these are the three categories, that is market, reputation, policy and legal. They are under transition risk, and the fourth category, which is under physical risk. The third topic in this is to identify and define range of scenarios. So scenarios are created based on the input parameters, assumptions, and analytical choices. Now, these scenarios are calculated based on the business impacts. So what would be the impact on various business factors such as supply chain, input costs, revenue, etc. What would be the response if some of these scenarios materialize? So suppose there is a particular risk that you know, how would you respond to it? So there could be change in business model, change to the portfolio mix of the business, or it could be investment in capabilities as well as new technologies. The last is the documentation as well as disclosing of this risk, including inputs, assumptions, analytical methods, and potential management responses. Now, these are the various considerations for climate risk. As you can see, the first are parameters. Discount rate, this is the rate at which organization is willing to accept the risk. Carbon price, usually it is decided by the government or the provincial government in their jurisdiction. Energy demand and mix. What is the energy demand and what is the energy mix? That is coal, the percentage of coal, gas, nuclear, renewable, etc. What is the price of key commodity prices? That is discussed here. Macroeconomic variables that are not part of the firm, which are like GDP, rate of inflation, unemployment, etc. Demographic variables, which is around population growth as well as migration. Efficiency, so what is the efficiency of clean energy and how could you incorporate it into your system? So the next is geographical tailoring, so you can tailor some of the effects of it. Technology is the thing that if new technology is there. Now for the analytical choices, there are scenarios, different type of scenarios could be there. There would be some aspects that are qualitative, there are some aspects that could be quantitative as well. What would be the timing of it? So how would you like to incorporate it in 2020, 30, 40 or something like that? What is the scope of application? How long you would like to how would you like to incorporate it? Physical risks, so what are the kind of risks that can affect your company? It could be hurricane, flood, etc. These are the different business impacts. There could be impact on earnings, cost, revenue, timing, assets, etc. Now, for the objective of scenario analysis, so the very first objective is to understand their impact on overall solvency of the firm. And it is mostly relevant to the asset manager who is investing in those. The second is to incorporate climate change into selection of investment. Asset managers as well as fund of fund managers or all those portfolio managers, it is more relevant to them. Assess risk opportunities to financial performance. All investors need it so that they can calculate their returns. Alignment to 2-degree scenario, so it is also relevant to asset owners, asset managers and product designers. Now there are some assumptions in energy transition models. These are based on temperature limits. So what should be the temperature limit? One of the most popular energy transition model is the IEA model. Time horizon, it would discuss about what is the time horizon. Emission reduction strategy, so how would you like to reduce the emission per decade or per year? What should be the distribution of emission reduction between different sectors? Which policies should be implemented and what should be its effect on overall reduction? Also, there is a talk about carbon capture and storage. So there are two different types of models. One of them, the different types of models are categorized into top down and bottom up. So in the top down model, that would be based on strategic asset allocation, or it would be based on asset liability management. Whereas in a bottom up, it would start from the company, then to the sector, and then to the portfolio. These would be the effects of climate change on different companies. So as you can see, if on assets, it can affect shortage of inputs. For the production, it can affect some production facilities, or it could also affect the logistical facilities as well. Expenditure, there would be expenditure due to increased cost of supplies or due to supply constraint. Also, you need to buy insurance for your production facilities, and that would be external cost to you. For revenue, there could be revenue to the or disruption to the production capacity. Loss of revenue due to failed delivery, you need to incorporate that in your estimate. Now these are the different type of models. So as you can see, transition scenario. So transition scenario is basically divided into two different things, which is portfolio impact assessment and borrower level calibration. So in a portfolio level assessment, there would be a systemic and repeatable approach to extrapolate the risk assessed by other models. Borrower level calibration, so different type of borrowers, their characteristics would be taken from different data sources, and then that would be calibrated to take them into consideration of transition scenario. So this is how it is done. So as you can see, there are different sector level risk factor pathways. Usually it is based on four. The first is direct emission cost. So these would be the direct cost that would incur due to climate change. The second is indirect emission cost. It could be due to your supply or due to external stakeholders. The third is low carbon capital expenditure. This is usually due to policy changes by the provincial or the federal government. Also, it could be due to revenue, which can be affected by any of these, or there could be other factors as well. So as you can see, then there would be segment sensitivities to it. So what is the different type of sensitivities that would be encapsulated in it? Thereafter, borrower level calibration, that is all the borrower characteristics would be taken from various data sources, and from there you would get an impact on expected loss that you can easily calculate, and from there you can find out the effect of climate change on different companies. So there are three different types, which are macroeconomic, sector level, and borrower level. So sectoral and borrower level are the bottom down, bottom to top approach, whereas macroeconomic are the top down approach. So in a macroeconomic model, they would be assessing impact of climate scenario based on some variables. However, since it is a top down approach, there won't be so much focus on sectoral allocation or sectoral effects. Also, what would be the impact of asset values based on different activities, based on different factors such as GDP, employment, etc., won't be discussed here. For sector level, as you can see, is a top-down approach. So it would assess impact of climate scenario through the performance of economic sectors. This would be majorly sector-specific. For the borrower level, it is a bottom-up approach. It would directly assess climate scenario. However, there is no existing comprehensive climate risk assessment that is bottom-up. There is always a problem of data. If you, the data is not enough, and you can't construct a bottom-up model. The ideal scenario would be to have a sector level plus a borrower level modeling that could capture the climate risk, but there are not so many models in that that mixture. So these are the various scenario characteristics. This is taken from an electricity company. So as you can see, they have different scenario models, which could be based on demand, price, investment cost, or carbon price. This is input into the model. Power characteristics, there are different metrics such as financial metrics, emission metrics, as well as production metrics would be taken in this model. Now how it is done, so there would be scenario adjusted financials. It would be based on revenue, so what is the revenue, what is the costing, and the capital expenditure or new plants that they want to construct. These all scenario adjusted financials would be encapsulated into scenario adjusted performance metrics, which could be based on cash flow, debt, earnings before interest, etc. This would then be compared with business as usual rating model, and from there a scenario implied probability of default or rating would be given. That would be the output of this. Usually this is given, the expected loss is usually given like this. So expected loss is equal to probability of default into loss given default into exposure at the default. So loss at default is usually by percentage. Probability of default is also percentage, whereas exposure of default is at some cash value. So these are types of models that would affect. As you can see, policy and technology are usually transition kind of a thing. In a policy kind of a scenario, there could be effects due to carbon cost, or due to emission cap, or due to subsidies, or it could be due to market expenses. there are various indicators for it. So carbon intensity could be one of the indicators. Policy announcement or country strategic plans could be indicator. Also, export data could also be an indicator. For technology, there could be a new technology, or there could be low carbon technology that would be affecting the particular company or the industry, or it could be based on competitiveness. There are different indicators for it, which is based on market and product analysis, market consideration, the technology scan, etc. The same way, another are the competitive landscape. So how competitive your market is, how fragmented your market is, you can have those indicators to competitive research. Risk appetite, what is the probability of default in your segment, and how the future segment is aligned to the present risk appetite. You can have risk appetite statement as your indicator. Operational activity, so how would you retain the talent, what is the excess financial capacity that you would keep for climate risk. The indicators could be review of bank capabilities and size of investment team. The physical risk assessment are based in different variables, which could be macroeconomic, supply chain, operator and assets, as well as markets. They are usually given by three scenarios, which are exposure, sensitivity, and adaptive capacity. Now, exposure is the exposure is for the counterparty to a physical risk. It is usually based on location. Sensitivity, it is based on dependence on factors which is most likely to be affected. Usually it is based on natural resources. Adaptive ability, this is the ability to adapt to hazard and mitigate it. So this is how the analysis is done here. You can easily read it and get through it. These are the different scenarios. So physical risk, acute and chronic, transition risk, policy and technology. Their impact could be macroeconomical, it could be due to supply chain, it could be due to market. These are the different depth in it, that is exposure, sensitivity and adaptive capacity. Outputs could be qualitative as well as quantitative, and the effect of this could be based on facility, firm, sector or country. Now the last topic that was discussed in this was about carbon delta formula, which was to study the aggregate impact of climate change. So these were the various formulas that were given. So the very first formula is CVAR. So there is a climate value at risk, and for the enterprise the formula is given like this, which is present value of climate cost divided by market value of enterprise. But if you want to divide, market value of enterprise would include equity as well as debt. But if you want to divide it into equity and debt, then there are two different formulas. For equity, it would be equity climate cost or profit divided by market value of equity. And it would be same for debt as well. Now another formula that was mentioned here was about sectoral emission intensity. So sectoral emission intensity would be based in emissions at the level of 2030 divided by revenue, which would be at 2030 plus green revenue at 2030. The total formula would be given in the ratio of tons per carbon dioxide equivalent divided by US dollar million. T sector wise, which is company sector wise one potential, so this would be given as revenue sector plus green revenue sector upon revenue company into green plus green revenue company into T sector. So this is how it is interpreted. So these were the topics that were discussed in these chapters. I hope you like this video. Subscribe to this channel, like, share and comment and we will meet soon.